Good morning. Thank you for the invitation. My name is Aristides Vrachatis. I am assistant professor in the Department of Informatics at the Ioannina University of Greece. Today I will present you a speech for the recent machine learning task for high dimensional data. We live in a digital world. In every minute, there are myriads of information is sent and received through the internet, as you can see here. We are in the big data era. Big data exists in almost all fields, such as manufacturing, energy, transportation, healthcare, generally in the biomedical domain, and so on. So we are in the era where the new oil is called data. That data guides us to do everything, and it's very important to have data nowadays. As you know, we are in the fourth industrial revolutions. The first industrial revolutions use water and steam in order to have mass productions. Then we have had electricity. The third revolutions had the automation in the electronics in order to produce to have massive productions. And now we are in the fourth industrial revolutions, which is actually artificial intelligence and Internet of Things, these combinations. And nowadays we can see that artificial intelligence, it's called AI, AI transforms the industry, the services, and create major challenge for the society. The major question here is, can computers show true intelligence? This is a major challenge. AI give all of these answers, since AI, or the entire umbrella of AI, because under this umbrella is the machine learning and the deep learning and all of these techniques. AI enable machine to understand their environment and to solve problems and act towards a specific goal. AI also tries to simulate the brain network. This is a very tough task, since the brain network, the brain is a very complex situation. But nowadays, using deep learning, we can do it better and simulate better the human brain. Also, machine learning offer all of these tools in order to mine the huge data formation, such as the classification, visualization, clustering, regression, and so on. Now, let's see the data from the computational perspective. We have raw data. We obtain raw data from a sensor, a wearable device, images, videos, and so on. Then we have a huge pre-process step in order to obtain the final matrix. In the computational aspect, we use this matrix in order to analyze it, to obtain to export information, to mine information, and so on. This data matrix have two specific features, the samples and the dimensions, the features, which is the dimensionality. Here, today we focus on small and large problems where we have data with few samples and large dimensionality. That means that we have small samples with a large number of features for each sample. Such data are everywhere. For example, in omics data, omics is a large variety of data like genomics, transcriptomics, micronomics, proteomics, metabolomics, and so on. Here we have hundreds of samples and tens of thousands of features. A typical transcriptomic study, in order to understand better, is has hundreds of cells, for example, 300 samples, and around 20,000 of genes. This is whole genome studies, which is our dimensionality. So we have to manage with 10,000 of dimensions. It's a very difficult task. In the computational aspect, we can fall here in the case of dimensionality. Case of dimensionality is a phenomenon that exist when we calculate distance in ultra high dimensions. In order to understand better, you can imagine that if I have two vectors, two genes or two samples with ultra high dimensionality, with 10 of thousands of dimensions, if I want to see the correlation or the distance, it's very difficult to extract significant information in ultra high dimensionality, because you can understand that the complexity here is ultra high. Also, the projection of data in two dimensions in a lower dimensional space offer a first insight into the structure of samples, a better view of the samples, and also can decode better and cope the challenge and cope all the challenges of the high dimensionality of the high dimensional data. First of all, the first choice to deal with high dimensional data is the dimensionality reduction approaches. Given data in D dimensions, where D is an ultra high number, the goal is to project it into a space with K dimensions, where K is a much smaller number, but trying to keep the structure of the initial data. So we have a D dimensions, very big dimensions, the goal to project it in a lower space, but in this space, in the lower space, in this space, we keep all the information of the initial data, of the original data. It has proven that in very large dimensions, when we have thousands of dimensions, the majority of the traditional dimensionality reduction techniques are not efficient. Here, I will present you some well-established and state-of-the-art dimensionality reduction techniques that are quite interesting. TSNE is a well-known and well-established dimensionality reduction techniques. It published at 2008. It has more than 23,000 of citations. It's a very a significant publication. Is a very promising dimensionality reduction technique. It is a non-linear dimensionality reduction technique, and also is well suited for embedding high dimensional data for visualizing in low dimensional space, or two or three dimensions mainly. TSNE comprises two main states. It constructs a probability distribution over the pairs of high dimensional object, and the next step is to define a similar probability distribution over the points in the low dimensional map. Actually, try to minimize the error when we go from the large dimensionality to the lower dimensions. Also, UMAP is a recently published and very promising dimensionality reduction technique. At the bottom, you can see it's published in the Nature Biotechnology. It's a very promising technique. It's a non-linear dimensionality reduction technique. It is similar to TSNE. The main difference here is that UMAP assumes that the data came from a uniform distribution, and also try to find the locally connected information to the locally preserving data through the Riemannian manifolds, and also to approximate also other approximations with locally constant. Now, TSNE and UMAP are two recent and well-established techniques, but they have few limitations when we deal with high-dimensional data. The limitations here is that they neglect the local density of data points in the original space. So, two recently published techniques, such as a dense NCNE and dense MAP, try to solve this limitation. These techniques, density preserving density preserving visualizing tools. Based on this technique, TSNE and UMAP, as you can imagine. And also, they demonstrate their ability to preserve to accurately incorporate information. And also, here, these tools try to achieve and the local density and the global density of the data in the original space. Also, fate is another another cutting-edge technique. It's a visualizing method. It can capture the both local and global nonlinear structures. You can see here that the crucial point here is that when we convert we use a dimensionality reduction technique, we want not only to preserve the local community, the local neighborhood, we want to find in the global community. For example, if one sample is very close to another sample, I want this information to transfer in the lower dimensional space, but also I want and the data that are far away. For example, if two samples are far away in the original space, I want this information to transfer also in the lower dimensional space. So I want and the local and the global nonlinear structure to keep in the lower dimensional space. Fate defines a manifold, it finds manifolds, it produces a lower dimensional embedding, it uses a very interesting embedding technique, and also it's a promising technique. You can see the reference in the bottom in order for a better study. Now I will explain in details two in-house approaches that are based on the random rejection. Random rejection is a dimensionality reduction technique with very, very promising results for high dimensional data. It is one of the most appropriate dimensionality reduction methods to deal with it, with such problems, with these challenges that we face in high dimensional data. Random rejection is a simple approach with low error rates when compared to other methods. As you can see here, given a matrix with d dimensions, as you can see here, the B matrix, we project the space to a K dimension space, which where K is a lower dimension, lower, a much smaller number than D. And we do that using a matrix, a random matrix A with D and this dimensions. As you can see here, it's very simple. We based only on one multiplication. The random matrix here can be generated using a Gaussian distribution or another distribution, such as Achleopta's method. He uses a simpler distribution with values 0, minus 1, and 1 in specific probabilities. And also the core idea behind the random projection is given in the Johnson-Littrestrouss lemma, which state that we can reduce the dimensions dramatically and be sure that the pairwise distance will maintain with a small error. The crucial point here is to keep the pairwise distance, to have the same pairwise distance in the original space, have the same pairwise distance in the lower dimensional space. This is the crucial challenge in the dimensionality reduction techniques. So we succeed that with random projections using the Johnson-Littrestrouss lemma. It is also impressive that this method worked well for data with hundreds of thousands or even millions of dimensions. Also, its inherent simplicity, because a very simple technique, allows parallel implementation to have parallel all the multiplication, which is a very crucial feature when we have to deal with computational complexity, memory management issues, and so on. Last but not least is that the calculation complexity of random projection, which is much smaller than PCA's complexity, since we don't need to calculate covariance matrix or eigenvalue decompositions and so on, we only need one multiplication. So the complexity and the computational effort is much, much smaller. Now, before 5 years ago, Cunningham and Samworth proved that multiple random projections, to use several random projections, not one random projection, can work efficiently in machine learning problems. The authors here thought to use an ensemble classifier with multiple random projections, but without taking into consideration the Johnson-Littrescu's lemma. They thought to remove this filter and to take only random projections with a specific with this specific criteria to select a fixed number to reduce the dimension in each projection. For example, they have a selection criteria by removing the bad projections. The authors take many random projections, they examine each projection separately, and they remove the bad projection. The projection, because random projections is based on a random matrix, it's very may one random projections to destroy your data. So definitely it's an excellent approach, this of Canning and Samworth. However, the further examination of each random projection creates a huge computational complexity, and it's also very create a huge complexity. So here we in our team we thought we published a recent study and we show empirically that we can use an ensemble classification approach using multiple random projections without this filter by keeping all projections, good projections and bad projections. Since we prove that we don't need to filter to remove the bad projections, since when I have several projections, I can achieve a better view of our data. Our main conception here, our main intuition was that it's not need to select the good projections in very high dimensions. So we apply this framework in biological data with ultra high dimensionality. We had the promising result, as you can see here, with compared to other similar approaches. You can see the superiority of our approach. And also the impressive here was that our parameter analysis showed that when we raised the dimensions of the projections, the classification performance was falling. So it's very impressive and very promising, since we need low dimensional space in order to have a reduced complexity. Now we transfer this knowledge into the visualization aspect and visualization domain. For this, we designed the RGTSNE visualization, an algorithm with three main steps. These steps are the data transformation to a pairwise similarity matrix, then to calculate the geodesic distance of this matrix, and then to apply TSNE in order to have a 2D visualization scheme. More details about our algorithm. Given a matrix with biological data, we project it to multiple different spaces, as you can see here, multiple random projected spaces, and we search for KNN neighbors for each sample. Then we aggregate the results by constructing a matrix with sample-sum similarities. Here is an example. As you can see here, we projected the space in multiple random projection spaces. Then we search for nearest neighbor, and the frequency for two samples belongs to the same neighborhood create the final matrix. This is the final distance and similarity matrix when we use this matrix as input in the geodesic distance criteria, when through the short path length we can obtain a matrix with geodesic distance of all sums. Then this matrix is used as input in the TSNE method, where we create 2D visualizations, as you can see here. This is also a promising algorithm, as you can see here in our results. You can see our superiority in comparing with DSME and PCA and other well-established techniques. Also, you can see here visualization, 2D visualizations. Here the data are with 10,000 of dimensions. We see the projection here in two dimensions. As you can see here, the RGTSNE, TSNE, and IsoMap and other tools. You can see here that our tool can separate better the classes here, the sample classes. This is the crucial point to separate the different classes of the data. Also here you can see other results. And let's go to conclude here. Today we see some recently published high dimensional dimensional reduction techniques for high dimensional data. Here the point is how to manage, how to deal with high dimensional data. High dimensional data are data with much more dimensions than the samples. Generally, big data are everywhere. AI can address the big data challenges. AI, so we need AI, we need AI, we need more and more AI. And as data production increases, the need for AI, the artificial intelligence tools, grows constantly. So we need more and more and more and more AI tools, especially in the domain of high dimensional data, where we need AI tools to manage the high dimensionality and the challenges of the high dimensional data. Thank you very much.
Hello, Aristides. Thank you very much for your insightful presentation. And I have a couple of questions for you. So you mentioned that AI can solve certain big data challenges. So what are the most actual challenges right now in the market?
Look, thank you for the question. Now in the market, we have several type of data types. There are two different types. There are when we have several samples or when we have several dimensions. For example, in the biomedical domains, we have the majority of experimental studies produce high dimensional data. For example, transcriptomic studies, single cell studies, RNA sequencing studies, all in all the biomedical domain, we face with high dimensional data. So we need tools in order to deal with this challenge, which is very crucial. The other part is when we have several samples, when we have ultra high samples, then we need high performance computing and similar techniques.
And as we know, when we speak about big data, usually not only the number of data matters, but as well the quality of it. So maybe you have found a secret recipe and can give a tip for our viewers working in such sector, how to get more of a quality data.
There's no recipe here. It's all machine learning is guided by the data. We have a data-driven approach here. And in each case, we have the problem, we have the data, and then we have the corresponding challenge. For example, as I said before, other recipe we need when we have high dimensional data, other recipe we have a small n-RASP problem, or large n-p, or small large n-RASP problem. So it depends on the case and on the data that we have. In its case.
Great. So thank you very much for your presentation and the answers to the questions. Have a nice day, and we will continue with a further agenda.
Thank you very much.